present to you James B. Madonna and the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman.
Okay. We're here.
You're here. We're here.
Sounds like Parliament in the UK.
I don't know what the hell they say. Do they still wear those ridiculous white powdered wigs?
Some of them do.
In Parliament?
In the court. In the court.
Yeah. I remember my Uncle John used to smoke cigarettes called Parliament.
Yes, they were around.
Was that correct? Is that the name of them?
That's correct.
Yeah, he was a Parliament smoker. And then my other uncle smoked Marlboro, and then another one smoked Camels, and they all smoked themselves
to death.
Well, Uncle John is still with us.
Huh?
Bless his heart, Uncle John. I salute you.
Salute Uncle John.
Yes.
He
gave up smoking eons ago.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
The other ones didn't. Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Uncensored Hard-Hitting Truth. I am your host, James P. Madonna of Megalife 21, and I am here with my illustrious co-host and mentor and the very founder of Newsletters Censored in 1977, the one and only, the Reverend Dr. William J. Eisenman. How are you feeling this week, sir?
Good. Good.
It's the end.
But I don't like this winter continuing.
It's the end of April 2015, but you wouldn't think it was spring by the weather we've been having in the northeast of the United States here in New Jersey. It's been cold, man. It's been an extended, elongated...
Seven-month winter.
Winter.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not saying we're getting snow and ice, but...
No.
But the wind chill, the temperatures, a lot of wind, which is to be expected. Rain, yes, but temperature-wise, it's been pretty cold. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean, Jelly Bean? All right. What the hell's that fucking sound?
They're building a roof.
What assholes, I swear to you.
They're building a pitched roof.
I'll give them a pitched roof.
A mobile home.
Idiots. Interfering with such a powerful cause here.
Whoa! They're putting a roof on, man!
I don't give a fuck. This is Newsletters Censored. This is Uncensored Hard-Hitting Truth. This is Capitalism in a Conch Shell Beyond Thunder Conch. That's what the... Because this...
Ladies and gentlemen, I present to you Mad Max.
Beyond Thunder Conch. Because I'm going to get very blunt and straight to the point, and it's not going to be kind. I'm not going to sugarcoat anything. But... I'm tired of pussyfooting around worrying about who's going to get offended, because that's got to stop. Beginning with this week's show and Capitalism in a Conch Show Beyond Thunder Conch. All right. Let's get to it. All right. You see, any poor or middle-class person in the United States, or the world for that matter, because there are problems with conservatives and corporatism in other areas like Australia. With racism towards Aborigines. My friend Shawnee Harris, Aboriginal civil rights activist from Western Australia, from the Outback. I send my greetings. And the right-wing corporatism is even worse over there, and the racism, it's neck and neck with the United States, but I think they're having a more severe problem with the conservative racists.
Because it's always been there. From when the first settlers were there, the crooks.
Yeah.
On Australia. The
mentality, the European invader mentality is the same as it was in the United States when they settled the United States.
Because they're better.
Huh?
They're better than the savages.
Everybody that's not like the rich white monarchies of Europe that stole everything from the indigenous people all over the world. Anybody who's not like them is a savage.
That's right. Now, even in Brazil, the aborigines, the original, are The indigenous people, they are protesting too, because Brazil is trying to take their land. So it's all over.
The government of Brazil is trying to steal their land from the native people of Brazil, and they're doing in the United States. The Republicans are trying to steal reservation land that belongs to Native Americans from them. Mm-hmm. So it seems to be a pattern. Australia, they're stealing sacred Aboriginal land for profit, for corporatism, and the sake of corporatism.
Hold up the conch, hold up the conch, hold up the conch, because that's where it is. That's where it is.
Now, do you see the pattern that's happening here with conservative corporatism and the right wing and all stemming from the white European monarchy, the invaders? It all falls into place, the mindset, the way of thinking, historical events, the persecution and abuse of indigenous people throughout the world. There's a pattern here forming. You know what I mean?
Yeah, the pattern is greed.
You got it.
You got land I want. I have the power to take it, I'm going to take it.
So they're going to take it by force, extortion.
Might make right.
And they're going to force you to accept their cultist religion by the sword.
And then I will write history. And I will write it in my favor, Pally.
Yeah. Now, the right-wing zealot evangelical fundamentalists in the United States, like the douchebag, was it Mike Huckabee?
Mike Huckabee! He'll bring down fire from heaven!
Mike Huckabee and Michelle Bubblehead Bachman and
Santorum.
Rick should be in a sanitarium, Santorum.
Yeah.
They all are preoccupied, the right-wing zealots, they're preoccupied with the anus. They're preoccupied with gay people.
Ooh.
And Huckabee said, now he's saying that gay people will end up criminalizing Christians. And Pat Robertson says that the gays, equal rights for gays and gay marriage will get Christians to like anal sex. So there seems to be a proclivity and a preoccupation with the rectum, with right-wingers.
They have a preoccupation with sex, period. Any kind of sex.
Yeah.
Any kind of pleasure.
Right.
Okay? They have a problem with that because they can't feel it. I've told you how many times they lack oxytocin.
Yeah, but that when you say it that way, it makes people pity them. They're evil. They shouldn't be pitied. They don't deserve to be pitied.
It's not, whoever pities them, you know, that's a problem. Because you don't pity a person, whether he has a disability or not, if he gets into a position of power and starts putting in policies that hurt you.
Hurt the poor.
Okay.
And send hungry children.
You don't pity that
person. Send children to bed hungry and take money away from the poor and veterans. And like in Florida with Rick Scott, the Q-tip head, making it illegal to feed the homeless in, what is it, over 30 states now?
33, I think.
33 states. Of course, they have Republican governors, right?
No, it's not states. It's cities.
It's city to city.
Yeah.
It's illegal to feed the homeless. Now, what I was getting back to before, any poor person or middle-class person who votes for a Republican is a bona fide idiot.
Bonehead.
Idiot. Bonehead is too kind. Imbecile. Moron. Bonehead. All right, we'll throw Bonehead in here.
Let me get back to that thing before I forget it, though.
And
anybody.
A proven idiot.
Anybody who pities a Hitler, there's something wrong. Okay? That you don't do. You cannot pity evil.
Well, I think the class warfare is perpetuated by the elitists and the right wing is the present day evil.
Well, it is an evil, that's for sure.
Because what's happening is, and the reason why I'm saying that if a poor or middle class person votes Republican, they're completely imbecilic, they're complete stupid ass, is because it's proven they do not have your best interest at all.
No.
Ask yourself a simple question. If you live in a red state and you're poor or middle class, what has the Republican senators, congressmen, and governors that you vote for, how have they collectively affected your life? Is your standard of living any higher? Is your life any easier by electing these Republicans? Middle class too, not just poor. Think to yourself, are things getting worse for you? Are they the same? Are they better? I can almost guarantee that they're worse.
Yeah, but we gotta stop those gays.
Now
you gotta stop people from having abortions.
Now what you're saying is you're putting their religious zealot cult
above
the basics, their bread and butter,
that's
survival,
true.
Paying the bills, putting a roof over their head, food on the table, clothes on their back.
That is how Republicans get voted.
You're putting the cult ahead of survival.
In a nutshell, in a conch shell too, you've just explained why they continue to get supporters.
And that makes them even more stupid.
Okay, of course.
Because a cult, even a religion, even if you quote the Bible accurately, which Republicans never do because they don't know the Bible, even if you quoted it and you knew what was inside of it, it's still not a proven fact. It's an ideology. It's based on faith, which is hope. It's not proven. Compared to proven science, cold hard facts of science, you don't have a pot to piss in, you don't have enough food in the refrigerator in your cabinets.
Maybe they don't have a refrigerator.
You're wearing socks with holes in it, underwear with holes in it. You're living in
paycheck to paycheck.
Paycheck
even
to paycheck.
If you have a job.
Yeah,
there you go.
And if you happen to have a job, being that the Republicans have arranged it so employers can do whatever they want, you know, you might be working long hours for less pay. You may not. Thank God for Obamacare. I mean, now you got some health care going. But if your life has not improved, and if it's gotten worse, even if you're middle class or poor, there's no reason for you to vote Republican.
No.
Now, if you believe in this crazy cult, because you're too lazy to read the Bible yourself, and you believe in this cult that believes that the poor should not be helped, and that you should give to the rich, well, you're far gone, man.
Yes, because there are hundreds of parts of the Bible who tell you, actually they tell you, your help for the poor, the Bible says, you should give them your two coats. Your two coats.
And feed them.
And if you have meat, invite them to the feast.
What about...
In other words, farmers,
they're supposed to leave a percentage of their crops.
Outside, yes. For the poor and the widows and homeless and everything to go in there and eat.
And harvest, yeah.
But the point is, what that is saying is you are required, if you have the things of this world, you are required to not help the poor per se, but to make the poor no longer poor. That's the problem with our social programs.
Right.
We just hand out a little meager crumb to them so that they don't die immediately.
Or is it about 1% of the total budget? Social services?
1%.
And what about corporations claiming ownership of the Earth's natural resources and withholding it for profit from people, from living things? I mean...
Well, in the old days, they just, you know, the country went in there with their military and they took over the resources. So now, of course, they got to use a little bit of mind work to get them these days.
Because, well, they want to privatize everything.
Yes.
I heard Chris Christie privatized water in New Jersey.
In New Jersey.
You know, they in South America, I was told when they privatized water, when they privatized the utilities, it was disastrous. It didn't work. Privatization never works in the long
run. Milton Friedman back in South America with the Pinochet and the other dictators in Argentina, etc. It didn't work. Milton Friedman's economic ideas are crap.
He was a Zionist piece of shit, right?
They were crap. I don't know what the hell he was, and I don't care. I said his economic advice is crap. And always has been.
But yet he
found political support from the right wing.
Right. And also, Ayn Rand probably had deep personal issues that made her write her books and tout her selfishness as a virtue.
Yeah, well, her...
She was ugly as all hell.
Jeez.
Well, look at people like, didn't somebody recently tell off Ann Coulter?
Yes, they did.
Yeah. Well, anyway, look.
That slowed her down, didn't it?
You gotta grab the bull by the horns with the right wing. You can't pussyfoot around. You gotta get tough. You gotta be real tough. And this is why they have been walking all over progressive liberals, because you have people like when Nancy Pelosi was Speaker of the House, was it? All she kept on saying is bipartisanship, compromise, bipartisanship. She wanted to make friends
the
enemy.
She wanted to govern.
Well, every time
Democrats
you compromise with
govern.
Them, you lose. The people lose. Every time
well,
you Democrats...
Well, that depends. That always depends. You didn't lose... You didn't lose back under Dwight D. Eisenhower when you had bipartisanship. It used to work. It no longer works because of the right-wing ideology. They cannot, they will not ever change their convictions.
Well, maybe the Republican Party in the 1950s, during Dwight D. Eisenhower, was not as extreme to the right
ideological
as they are today.
It was not.
They probably were not as corporatist as they are today.
That too.
You know, well,
the Pentagon was not as popular and big as it was. Dwight D. Eisenhower warned against the military-industrial complex back then.
Yeah, well, I listened to that video with George Carlin again. I mean, the guy's way ahead of his time. He was right on the money. I mean, he summed it all up about how the system is rigged and who controls everything, and they're all bought out.
And today Republicans have one agenda, and the agenda is to destroy the middle class.
Now,
and
yes,
when you destroy the middle class, of course, the classes underneath go down too.
Then you end up with a bunch of desperate slaves.
That's it.
Now,
wheels in the cog of industry.
Yep. All right, two examples.
Or cogs in the wheel of industry.
Two examples. A franchise, a Papa John franchise owner.
Oh, that's idiot.
In New York City, M Star Pizza, who owns 7 Papa John's, was ordered to pay $800,000 in wage theft.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yep.
And of course, the CEO of Papa John, he's the one that refused to give health care to his employees, and he also said that the prosperity of the company, he is not obligated to share with his employees the prosperity of Papa John's Pizza, which means that is a prime example of how trickle-down does not work, because they won't allow it to work. They won't allow it to work.
It's an example of when you let corporations get too big, too much influence. That's what you're doing.
They, you know, trickling, when you're stealing wages and you refuse to give health care, and you claim that if the company improves, it's not gonna, you're not gonna benefit from it. That's not trickle down. Mm-hmm. What it is siphon up economics.
Mm-hmm.
Siphon up to the top 20%. The devil's economics. Okay.
Yeah, we've had that since the 1970s.
That was a siphon, by the way.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, so that's proof. Trickle down is bullshit. Chris Christie, bless his heart, bless his fat, blubbery heart. In total, he gave away $5.4 billion in corporate subsidies, all taxpayers' money, while cutting school aid, cutting property relief, and cutting and skipping pension payments.
Uh-huh.
You know, in other words, you footed the bill, the free corporate welfare.
Uh-huh.
You paid for it.
Uh-huh.
But when it comes time for you to expect a little help from your governor, Chris Christie, you got turned down. But his rich buddies were not turned down,
mm-hmm,
and they got all this free money.
Oh, that will provide jobs. That will provide
where?
Jobs.
Where?
Well, it hasn't worked in New Jersey.
Hasn't worked
anywhere. Hasn't worked elsewhere either, but yeah. But they keep doing it.
In a
they
way...
keep using that excuse.
In a way, it hasn't really worked in China, India, Bangladesh, or whatever, because those people, those so-called jobs that they created in the third world countries are like almost not having a job at all. I mean, what is it in China? 32 cents an hour at Foxconn?
Mm-hmm.
50 cents an hour in the Philippines for office work?
Mm-hmm.
50 cents to a dollar. Bangladesh, I think, is like 14 cents.
I know a guy who works for Mercedes-Benz here in, where are they? They're up in Rochelle Park or something? Mercedes-Benz.
Bergen County somewhere?
Oh, yeah. They're right here.
Mm-hmm.
$15 an hour.
What does he do?
He seems to be well-educated in what he does. He's on the phone. Not a telemarketer or anything like that.
A buyer?
You call in and you say something's wrong with the car. Then he helps you out or puts you in touch with people. In other words, though, he has to have that knowledge.
Help desk.
No, it's not one of those things. He has to have the knowledge of the
automotive
mechanic, etc., to do this job for $15 an hour.
So he'll get information about your vehicle, and he'll give you an estimate or something.
You can do a lot of stuff before he turns you over to somebody else.
Right. You can say, look, I need a part for my car. Do you have it in stock?
Well, he's not a stock man either. You know, it's more than that.
Then he deserves
more. You know,
more.
Like the help desk, you say, well, they just put you on to somebody else.
Well, if he has that kind of knowledge, he deserves more than $15 an hour.
That's correct. That's my point. And now they've shipped him down to Atlanta to do some work for that. For $15 an hour.
Relocation for a lousy $15 an hour?
Yeah.
To Atlanta?
That's my point.
That's bullshit. That's chump change.
That's what they've done today. They made important jobs into non-important.
That's supposed to be a more accurate minimum wage, not for skilled labor.
Well, not minimum wage, that's for sure.
$15 an hour. That's chump change for a knowledgeable, skilled person.
And not only that, they keep them at below 40 hours so that they don't pay him full time.
It's bullshit that
they've had the laws to do that.
He had to relocate to Atlanta?
No. He'll come back in a couple of days. He's down there doing work for them.
At $15 an hour?
At $15 an hour.
Fuck that.
That's what we have, ladies and gentlemen. Total control by the corporations and the plutocracy.
The ultimate douchebag award, of course, the Papa John franchise owners.
Back to him, yes.
And that big douchebag, that CEO, should have wrote down his name. Every time there's an article about Papa John, they show his face, but they never print his name. He's not Italian. He has nothing to do with how to make a real pizza.
That's for sure.
Yeah, he's got like a German or a Jewish last name or something, but he's a douchebag. You can tell he does all the Papa John commercials because he probably doesn't want to pay professional commercial actors and actresses, and he does it himself. And, you know, of course, mention right-wing pastors. They're ultimate douchebags. But every week they come out with preposterous, despicable, utterly ridiculous statements, the right wing.
And they get influence, and they get people who admire them.
And nobody from the media calls them out, challenges them, rebuttals them.
No.
None.
You're not going to get any of that in corporate media.
No matter how asinine they sound.
No. Yeah, I was listening to a video last night with Howard Stern criticizing, I forgot who it was.
They want to...
Some right-wing idiot.
Well, Howard Stern's a very intelligent
person. Very intelligent
person.
Man,
I hear they're pushing for mandatory vaccinations in California.
What about here?
That's mandatory slow genocide of the mainstream masses.
A new thing just came out and said there's no connection between vaccinations and autism.
Bullshit. Lies.
Okay.
Lies from Big Pharma.
Lies. I was listening to Noam Chomsky, and he was describing what has happened. Like since the 1950s. In the 1950s, your big, powerful corporations and etc. were in the electronics fields and stuff of that nature. Today, it's Big Pharma and those fields, which are in power.
Because that's where the big bucks are.
That's correct.
In other words, instead of doing what would benefit mankind, which would be high technology, electronics, you know, other things, the green movement, they chose to invest their money in pharmaceuticals, in poisons,
Well, that's what grew, you see. And that's why we're paying so much for health care in this country compared to all the other countries, etc. That's where the money goes. Siphoning up!
And that's why when you walk into a doctor's office, the first thing out of their mouth is, what kind of insurance do you have?
Good.
Not even, you know, hello, welcome to our medical center, or good afternoon, sir. No. What kind of insurance do you have?
What's your problem?
What are you here for? Yeah, first it's insurance.
Insurance.
Motherfuckers.
And then you got to fill out the forms. And then maybe they'll ask you, what are you here for? What's wrong?
Well, you never see the doctor with the appointment they give you.
Oh, hell no.
You go and you have two waiting rooms. You have the big waiting room and you have the little waiting room, like Jerry Seinfeld joked about. The little waiting room. And, you know, when you finally get to see him, of course, he rushes you along, doesn't spend too much time with
you. I remember going to see my urologist once. And, you know, he puts you in a room, you're sitting in a room there, and he gets a phone call in another room, and I could hear what's going on. He's talking to his broker. He's yakking with his stinking broker. I'm sitting in the room.
Yeah. I only had... Most urologists seem to be men. I only had one woman check me out, and she did it in a nanosecond. Like, almost like she was nervous or embarrassed or something.
Nah, I don't think so.
It was, like, really freaking quick. You know, where
would... She grab your ball and say cough?
No, not even. No.
Well, that's an inadequate, examination.
Yeah, I mean, they're supposed to jiggle your culoons.
That's right.
Your gonads. Jiggle them around a little bit.
Make a little squeeze, they cough.
Put a disposable sterilized glove and stick it up, fingers up your ass, and feel your prostate. Or as my grandfather used to say, prostrate.
Prostrate.
I don't have my prostrate checked.
Laying on the ground. Prostrate.
Prostrate. Alright, let us...
Actually, when I went to you, I never got the finger. Never got the finger thingy.
You never got your prostate jiggled?
No, because when I went, I was distended because there was no exit.
What?
No exit for the pee-pee.
What do you mean, no exit?
The pee-pee was blocked.
You had a block?
And would not come out.
You had a block ureter?
Not the ureter.
Urethra?
The bladder, probably.
Oh, the bladder?
Or the prostate.
Oh, that's bad. You mean the urine, you couldn't pass urine?
No passing urine.
That could be toxic, right?
When I was undistended by the catheter, it was well over 2 liters that gushed out.
Holy shit.
No, what happened was I
2 liters.
I had taken a herb product for post-polio, and it contained ephedra. And ephedra blew up the prostate.
Really?
Ephedra can do that. All of your, like, your congestion relievers, which have ephedra in them, and, you know, Sudafed, all these things, that can do that. Can do that.
Yeah,
Be careful.
I had discomfort down here when I was taking DHEA one time.
I never had any problem with DHEA.
No. Yeah. Well, they do have it in 10 milligrams in capsule form now.
I only do 5.
Milligrams?
Yeah.
Yeah, they have a Swanson.
Is it micrograms or milligrams?
Milligrams.
5 milligrams.
Wait a minute. No, milligrams.
No, wait a minute. 25.
25
is for women's, I think.
5, 10.
5, 10.
Well, it depends on the age of the woman, too.
Yeah. 25, I do it.
The older you are, the more a candidate
you are
for DHEA.
Right.
It's an over-the-counter hormone. I'd say it's about two steps away from free testosterone in the blood.
Well, it helps with producing your other hormones. You know, like pregnenolone.
Precursor?
And all of, yeah, it's a precursor.
Oh, okay. And it's produced by the adrenals, by the adrenal glands, mm-hmm. the HGA, and then it depletes with age.
Yes.
Declines. All right, let's sink our teeth into these readings.
All right, I have a large section here on the situation with a Dr. Oz.
Oh, yes.
So I don't think I'm going to, you know, need to read all of it, but let's get a...
Mehmet.
Let's get a general idea of what's going on here.
Mehmet, sounds like a frog, right?
Mehmet Oz. Dr. Mehmet Oz says last week's attack...
Mehmet.
...by 10 doctors... who accused him of promoting quack treatments on his TV show was spurred by his vocal support for labeling genetically modified foods.
And that's all he did. And he was right. He was correct.
A stance that he says some, if not all, of those accusers oppose.
Oh, heaven forbid we should know what we put in our bodies as a consumer.
Oh, no. Because then we won't buy the product.
Too bad.
Well, we have to buy the product.
I don't have to do anything.
You know, those corporations need us to buy the product.
My loyalty is to my well-being, health included, and my wallet.
Oh, excuse me. The Diagnostic Statistical Manual now has a designation for you.
Yes.
For people who are interested in their health.
Yes.
Yes, they do. We are now mentally ill.
We have...
Officially!
So it is a neurosis. It is a compulsive neurosis to be a health nut.
That's correct.
To be a concern with one's health.
That's correct.
To seek optimum health.
That's great.
That's okay.
That's great.
That's okay.
And, of course, you know, the oppositional, thing against authority, that also is a mental illness.
Yeah. I don't like to follow orders.
You know? Dr. Oz lives in Cliffside Park, New Jersey.
Oh, well.
Devoted for the first half of his syndicated show on Thursday to his response.
Yeah, we're not far from Cliffside Park.
No. To what he called a brazen letter from 10 mysterious doctors.
Brazen.
Well, the quackbusters always work from behind the scenes, you know.
Well, you know...
They don't step out because they will not debate you.
Oz is not... Dr. Oz is not alone. There are many people with lots of evidence that GMOs are toxic.
It don't just involve GMOs. I mean, these quackbusters are after anybody who does not hold to the official line of medicine.
Let me ask you a question. Do they also defend vaccines?
Yes, they do.
The quackbusters do,
yes.
In other words, they're big pharma corporate whores.
Yes, they are. But, they don't like you to find that out.
Well, I'm saying it.
I know, but they don't like you to find that out.
It's very obvious.
There were many times when, like, they would go on shows and debate people and the show sponsor or whatever would never tell you that they are beholding to this, that, and the other corporation, or FDA, or Big Pharma, or whatever.
Well, because the station managers or whatever their corporate suck ups. They have sponsors.
Yeah.
You know, it's up to the people to ascertain the truth by listening.
Well, hey, the elites know best, don't they? For us.
Fuck them.
Don't they know best?
They live high on a hog. We don't. So why should I worry about what they care about?
Anyway, these 10 mysterious doctors sent to Columbia University, where Oz is vice chairman,
of the surgery department and performs heart surgery at New York Presbyterian, Columbia's affiliated hospital. The letter accused him of egregious lack of integrity.
Oh.
And urged the university to remove him from the faculty.
So he, Dr. Oz, is a form of whistleblower. Which is supposed to be a person who is doing their job and is heroic.
Well, yeah, but even besides that,
an honest person.
He has a First Amendment right to freedom of speech.
Yes.
Does he not?
Hey, if he doesn't, you might as well just tell the American people that we're tossing the Constitution and the Bill of Rights right into the sewer.
Well, as George Bush was supposedly have said, it's just a goddamn piece of paper.
Well,
and he's right, because if you don't enforce it,
it's paper.
It's just a goddamn piece of paper.
Hey, if two people don't adhere to their marriage vows, marriage is just a damn piece of paper.
Well, yeah.
If people, you know...
And in politics, if you just have two ideas bang heads with each other, you know, no resorting to facts or science or something else, it's just one idea against another idea.
And they'll be like two bighorn sheep knocking heads, butting heads
from
forever.
From now on till eternity.
Yeah, like that little science toy, you know, the steel balls that tap
on
the string that they keep on hitting each other.
Yeah. Take the one and ding,
bing, ding, bing, 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 bing.
Yeah.
And then you go nowhere.
Absolutely. Absolutely. A Columbia spokesman defended Dr. Oz by saying the school is committed to the principle of academic freedom. But the letter set off a new round of criticism of Dr. Oz, who has been slammed for promoting questionable cure-alls and last June appeared before the Senate's Consumer Protection Panel, where he was scolded for claims he had made on his show about weight loss aids. I believe that was Garcinia Cambogia. And the green bean coffee.
Oh, well, green coffee, they work.
Well, that's what he was saying. Claims, he says, he has stopped making.
Hey, chromium picolinate works too. You know, I mean, these things, they all work, and they all have lots of evidence to support them. If one cares to read them.
Now you got to something.
If they're there, if one cares to read them.
Yeah. But if you are of the officialdom, you don't read them.
Didn't you tell me one time Gary Knoll went to court and he had tons of evidence on his side?
He went to a debate with that too. He dropped down on the stage.
What?
Thousands of pages of studies and etc.
Right. But nobody cared.
No,
they didn't care.
In fact, he had a run-in one time with one quackbuster, and he wanted to give him some of the stuff.
Old-fashioned knuckle sandwich.
He wanted to give him some of the studies and etc. to read so that it might help him. And then the guy said, "I don't want them."
Yeah, because the guy is a corporate whore.
Yeah, well, he didn't think he could be educated anymore either. I mean, you know, that's a bad
thing. Arrogance.
Oh, yeah. Suppose your doctor went to school 20 years ago.
I'm right? Hearing you.
Yeah. Suppose your doctor went to school 20 years ago.
Right.
And he hasn't kept up in the meantime, just been doing his practice and et cetera, et cetera.
Oh, man.
What kind of doctor is that?
An old country doctor.
Yeah, yeah.
Like Bones McCoy.
But at least he had Yeah, Bones had,
Bones was good.
Yeah, well, he had the modern equipment and stuff, you know?
Yeah, I know what you mean. You mean like it's like going to a dentist who's like Doc Holliday, you know? Give you a bottle of whiskey for anesthesia and pull your teeth out.
When could I eat on laughing gas?
Laughing gas? Nah, you got lidocaine, Novocaine. Come on, laughing
those
gas.
Things too. But some of them use the laughing gas.
But yeah, you got to keep up. You got to keep up with.
Huh? If you're female, then they try to rape you, or do something.
You know that has been done.
Yes, it has.
There was a dentist who was notorious for doing that.
Yes.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
New Yorker writer Michael Spector, who profiled Dr. Oz for that magazine 2 years ago, said on NPR this week that whereas every doctor's first obligation is to do no harm, Oz does harm every time he goes on the air.
Oh, and if Oz was, and I used to call Oz a big pharma
whore.
Can you imagine these quack busters? They're real whores. So pushing toxic drugs and vaccines, that's doing good for the patient. That's doing good.
Well, you know, it's like this. The doctors of officialdom want you to die of their treatment, which does not work, rather than have a treatment that might work or does work. Okay?
My family doctor only believes in...
There you go.
In like a few supplements. Omega-3 fish oils, vitamin D, and, you know, you could take a calcium here and there. Other than that, he don't put any stock in anything but his drugs.
I have a lady friend.
Prescription,
Who's a doctor, has just told her to take vitamin D3. And she doesn't take anything else.
Idiot.
But I told her, I said, well, the only reason that your doctor is asking you to take D3 right now is because they have changed the what used to be the RDA for that particular vitamin. That's all.
Not only that, they're acknowledging that vitamin D does a lot more than just help you absorb calcium into your bones.
How many years did they say, don't take any more than 400 micrograms?
I know.
No more.
Toxic. It's toxic.
Yeah.
And you know, vitamin D is very important for the immune system, just like vitamin A.
Yeah.
You know?
Absolutely.
I will be taking very soon this mega cod liver oil because I wish to have my A and D a 100% animal source from fish livers.
Liver oil. There was something the other day on some program, and they were. There's an attack right now against beta carotene.
Well, synthetic beta carotene is a problem with it.
Right. Exactly. Exactly.
Synthetic.
And that is exactly what they are putting in for vitamin A in many, many multis now.
You're right about that.
It's the beta-carotene.
It's either the synthetic beta-carotene or a combination of that and palmitate, retinol palmitate, which is the dry...
I don't have a problem with the palmitate, but like the fish oil, the natural source, is like down to 40% of those 10,000 IUs.
So
that's like 6,000 IUs of fake beta carotene, and the other four, or whatever, you know.
It's the dry form.
Or palmitate.
Yeah, I like the oil-based animal source vitamin A.
Preformed.
Right, retinol.
Yeah.
Retinol, O-L, from animal source, you know, in a fat-soluble form.
Anyway, he He does harm by recommending things for which there's no evidence.
But they won't read the evidence.
Bingo, so there's no evidence for them.
In other words, I see nothing.
I hear nothing.
Sergeant Schultz from Hogan Zeroes. Listen, it's so preposterous. Let's say this was 5 feet thick, and this representing all the proof that Gary Noel dropped on the floor in court, and nobody wants to read it, then how the hell could they say there's no evidence?
Because it doesn't exist.
Because they make believe they don't see it.
That's right.
Okay. That's like people saying, what? You saw a UFO, a green cylindrical or cigar-shaped thing hovering in the sky? I don't see it.
Well, hey,
you know, and then you take a video with your smartphone, and you go, look.
Yeah, but we have something called science. And in science, you have to prove things.
Double blind placebo study, and yes, they use the double blind placebo study.
They didn't use it for bypass.
In nutrient, huh?
They didn't use it for bypass.
But they've used it for many nutritional supplementation.
Yes, they do for that. But I'm saying regular official medicine has not used that gold standard for a lot of their treatments, and yet their treatments are in effect. And bypass is one of them.
What about companies?
Hysterectomy is another.
What about companies like Merck?
Tonsillitis, tonsils.
What about companies like Merck getting hit with lawsuits? Recalling prescription drugs that the FDA okayed.
Well, right now, if you're watching television in the afternoon, you're seeing lawyers telling you if you took Xarelto to call them up right away, and if you had a bleeding episode, and guess what?
What?
Xarelto is still being advertised by the big drug company.
Hey, there's a psychiatric drug given to children that causes boys to grow breasts, gynecomastia. Yeah, and then it's a law firm, a medical malpractice or personal injury or whatever the hell they are. At night, there's loads of these
law firm
commercials that say, if you took this and you had these symptoms. Now the IUD, Morena IUD, intrauterine device, has a tendency to get embedded in the woman's uterus. So that's another lawsuit going on.
New York Times columnist Frank Bruni called Oz a carnival barker.
Oh, he's calling him a snake oil salesman, a carny.
And a one-man morality play about the temptations of mammon and the seduction of applause. Launched in 2009, the Dr. Oz show has often been criticized for mixing rigorous and dubious science. Oz sees his show as a forum for discussing many health practices to better inform his viewers. And he wondered what accounted for the timing of last week's letter. He said, it is his opposition to legislation that would strip government agencies of their ability to label genetically modified foods. Now, if you want to continue with a little bit more on Dr. Oz, I have a little bit more, but I mean, I think that sort of sums it up. No.
Well, I mean,
not now. No.
But would it add some information to the Dr. Oz?
I think, according to my reading of it, I think it is more. They are trying to limit his defense. They're saying things like the PR firms or something. Oh, if he gets so defensive and he defends himself and everything, he's going to do harm to his case.
In other words, they want him to shut the hell up.
They want him...
And not defend it.
They want him to fold like a cheap camera.
Camera. Now you're talking.
Like a coward.
Yeah, so maybe this might add a little, you know...
Yeah, okay.
A little more nuance.
They want to basically take away his constitutional rights to...
To defend himself.
To defend himself and to speak openly, freely, and honestly while he's under oath.
Exactly.
So it's like it's the root court, right?
Well, he ain't under no oath. It's 10 mysterious doctors. Quackbusters. Who are trying to get at him, that's all.
Is Oz by himself... In this hearing?
There's no hearing.
They're just...
It's nothing. It's a letter.
They're just trying to
bust... It's a letter that the Quackbusters sent to Columbia University saying, hey, fire Dr. Oz. We don't like what he's saying. That's all it is.
Well, I blame the dean or...
Well, he defended him. He said he has a right to his freedom of speech.
Damn well. You're damn right he does.
But the Quackbusters have power and influence, and they work behind the scenes. So you never know.
Who runs Columbia University? Not the Quackbusters, right?
No, whatever money they get. That's who runs the university.
Oh.
Okay?
Oh, it's kind of like a two-party system politician running for president in 2016... with big campaign contributions?
Yeah, and whoever gives him the most, they pull his strings.
Gotcha.
That's the way America works.
That's why capitalism sucks, and it is the devil's economics.
Yeah.
Hey.
But it is... Until change occurs, our economics.
The money.
And that's the problem.
The money is still in politics.
Yeah.
It's like. And even when religious nuts try to interfere in politics, nobody calls them out. Nobody reprimands them. They let them...
Well, you see what happened when the IRS tried to control
that. They should tax them. They should
situation.
Make them pay taxes if they interfere with politics.
Yeah, but that's the point. You see, remember you said before we went on the air, I said, if nobody checks and balances, if nobody oversees, any laws or any things that you want... are worthless. Because nobody's going to hold anybody's feet to the fire.
Nobody's being held accountable.
That's correct.
At all.
And that's the situation we have. There are no,
I mean,
people to back up anything.
G.W. Bush and the demon Dick Cheney, they got away with...
Yes. The SEC didn't do a damn thing to Wall Street. During Bush's administration.
They got away with war crimes, right?
That too.
Corruption.
Now who's going to... The court at The Hague tried. Spain tried.
Obama pardoned.
Well, he didn't pardon it, but they shut it down. They shut it down, baby.
But if the shoe was on the other foot, the Republicans would have went after Obama. The Democrat.
Of course.
Like they're going after him.
Of course.
They're going after Obama simply because he's the black man in the White House.
Mitch McConnell said that from when he was elected.
Not because of...
We haven't gotten it yet.
Not because of Obama's track record or...
Yeah, his socialism. His socialism. Obama's socialism.
Hey, all I know is... If a socialist regime does a hell of a lot for the little guy...
As it would,
more power to them.
There you go.
That's how I look at it.
But socialism and communism have been painted with the red scare brush. Totalitarianism!
These are imbeciles who...
who run the country.
Who do not know the definition of these political terms.
That's correct, but do you see the Republican? They don't even know what a vagina is or what it does.
You know, most Americans, the average American was asked the question, and the average American, now these are the people that supposedly vote.
Uh-huh.
They actually think that the sun revolves around the earth.
Oh, geez, they did that back, in the Middle Ages, for granted.
So that means the earth is like the center of the universe.
No evolution.
And nobody else counts.
No evolution.
These people believe, they question.
There's
random,
an organization in the UK that believes the earth is flat.
Say what? Huh?
Yes.
They might as well join the Marshall Applewhite Heaven's Gate people.
Well, they're dead.
They're dead, but somebody's keeping the website alive.
I don't know who's paying their server.
Anyway, let's break for lunch.
Yes!
And you'll be joined by the Bible verse truths, the Bible truths of how to defeat a conservative. And please feel free to pause. Hit the pause button and study them.
Yeah.
Followed by our voiceover artist, William H. Morrow III, with his words of wisdom and promo. Mm. William Hamilton Morrow the Toid. The Toid.
Where's the second?
His dad.
Ah.
His grandfather was the first.
Ah, okay.
Well, there is no first.
Yeah.
Oh, wait a minute. There is no second. It's just, somebody explain to me. There technically is William Hamilton Morrow.
Yeah.
Then there's William Hamilton Morrow Jr. And then if there's another one, then he's the third.
Maybe.
That's what you're supposed.
Maybe that's how they do it.
That's how you're supposed to say it.
Maybe that's how they do it.
All right, we'll catch you later.
I'm the first.
Well, you're the only.
No, I'm not the first within my whole, clan.
No, I'm talking about your family. Are you the first William Joseph
Eisen?
What?
John.
Your middle name is John?
Joseph. Oh my God.
You told me Joseph.
I never said a word at Joseph.
You keep on changing your mind about everything.
You know.
Is it John?
You and Talmo better get together.
Well, don't say Joseph next week.
I ain't gonna say Joseph anytime.
Okay, it's John.
Yeah.
It's not a Lily.
Like John the Baptist.
It's not Lily White, like Edward Lily White Norton.
No, it's
from the
John.
Honey or Honeymooners, Lily White.
John.
Lily White. All right, we'll see you.
John the Baptist.
Yeah.
This is William H. Morrow. The best way to join our organization is to get your free annual subscription to Newsletter Censored with your gift to support this work. The newsletter of hard-hitting truth and news fighting censorship and conservative propaganda since 1977. There is nothing out there like the Newsletter Censored in the mainstream media or the press. This newsletter is the very best way to join and be a part of our organization. We're living the end times. so you need Newsletter Censored. Go to www.newslettercensored.com. Hey, listen, for the real hard-hitting truth, you need Newsletter Censored. And now, back to the show. Bye-bye.
Okay, we are back.
Thank you very much, William Hamilton Morrow III, for your words of wisdom and promo. Now we return for the balance of this week's show. Uncensored, hard-hitting truth.
Continuing with Dr. Oz. The problem he has is that the letter was not an isolated incident, said Stephen Fink, president of Lexicon Communications of Los Angeles, specializing in crisis communication. The best thing he can do is muster the facts and see if they do lend credence to his side of the story. The louder he criticizes his critics, the more likely he will lose the bully pulpit he has built over the years. So you see what he's saying? If he defends himself too much, he's going to lose it.
But these...
Now, how do you do that?
These quackbusters are blatant liars. They're whores for Big Pharma.
And they are insatiable. They've been around for years. Okay?
They must be exposed.
And you can beat them. Like Gary Knowles, beat them in court, and they still come back. They're like ants in the springtime. Or cockroaches. You know? In your house. They keep coming and coming.
What about saying, I thought I dealt with you scoundrels before. Why should I pay attention to your letter again?
You know,
I will file it under G for garbage.
What happens with a lot of the, like, let's say you have a problem with a drug and you sue the pharmaceutical company. And then they settle with you, and you have to sign a non-disclosure agreement, which says you will not talk about the case.
Well, they better pay me, if it is me, a lot of money. They better make it worth my while.
Well,
for me to keep my mouth shut.
That is what has happened, because several of the pharmaceuticals companies have been sued many, many, many times. And you don't hear about it.
And the reason why, and I guess the result of not hearing about it, is that you have a population of people who put so much unnecessary trust and faith in drugs.
They don't lose any of their goodwill and goodness. They lose none of that.
Yeah, their reputation is not tainted.
Reputation,
it's
that's
not
what I
tainted.
Wanted to say, yes.
The reputation of Big Pharma is not tainted because all these lawsuits are never brought to public.
Correct. Oz's publicist did not return a request for comment on Friday. A Columbia spokesman defended Oz this week, saying the school is committed to the principle of academic freedom. The latest backlash follows a meteoric rise in fame. A Harvard graduate who earned both a medical and business degree at the University of Pennsylvania, Dr. Oz became a respected cardiologist at New York Presbyterian and a professor of surgery at Columbia University.
The man has
credentials.
He's got awesome credentials.
For years, he lived a rather quiet life in Cliffside Park with his wife, Lisa, and four children. His first bit of fame came in 1996 when he successfully transplanted a heart
into Frank Torrey, Joseph Torrey's...
I remember that.
...brother.
I didn't know that he did it. He did the surgery. I remember that.
While the team was batting for its first World Series title in 18 years. Speaking of that, according to yesterday, I think, before their game with the Mets, their Subway Series, the Mets were 11 straight.
That's when the Mets had Mike Piazza.
No, now.
Oh, now. Oh, they are 11 straight?
Now they played the Yankees. They were playing a three-game Subway Series. So I don't know if they lost or won at that game, but they were 11 straight before that.
I'm a Red Sox fan. Anyway.
Oz became an overnight hit. He made appearances at hospital news conferences. He went to Yankee Stadium for a life photo shoot. 2 years later, he wrote Healing from the Heart, a book that suggested combining Western medicine with everything from acupuncture and hypnosis to aromatherapy and energy healing. See why they're after him?
Well, see, I had a problem with Oz when he did a show about anti-aging, and the only thing he really said was
calorie restricted.
No, well, he says I recommend Botox injections.
That's crazy.
You know, he didn't.
Yeah, I know.
He didn't talk about antioxidants. He didn't talk about anything like that, supplementation. In terms of antioxidants, ORAC score, you know, he just talked about Botox injections.
No, that's not anti-aging. That's just plastic surgery.
Yeah, that's just a superficial cosmetic treatment.
The book received some backlash in the medical community for supporting techniques that had no scientific backing.
Right.
Now, there are thousands and thousands of studies on acupuncture. How can you come out and say it has no scientific backing? But yet, you just saw it. They got away with
it. Acupuncture is thousands of years old. I mean, you know, it's time proven. Just because a bunch of drug-pushing stooges, shills, whores, you know, not to use the word whore over and over, you know, just because they say so, I mean, they can't discredit something that was used in ancient times effectively.
Soon, Dr. Oz had a show, Second Opinion, on the Discovery Channel, where he dispensed advice mostly to celebrities like Magic Johnson and Charlie Sheen.
Charlie Sheen.
But Dr. Oz got an even bigger platform when he became a regular on the Oprah Winfrey Show.
Yeah, anybody who Oprah takes a liking to gets their own show.
Like a doctor?
Dr. Phil, you know.
Who could explain heart disease and preventive medicine in eloquent sound bites. Some colleagues credited him with bringing sound medical advice to the masses. Others thought he advocated too much for treatments, supplements, and food, whose health benefits were, at best, unknown.
They're not unknown, it's just that they don't like the established healthcare industry and their lobbyists and their cronies. They don't like people to maintain optimum health and quality longevity, because then you don't become a customer of their big pharma healthcare system.
Winfrey began calling him America's doctor.
Yeah, I would say so, yeah.
And in 2009, Dr. Oz had his own daytime syndicated show,
which now reaches 2 million viewers each weekday.
Oh, that's it? 2 million?
That's a
lot. It's a daytime show.
Is it on cable? Must be on cable, only 2 million visitors, you know.
No, it's he's on a major network.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Well, 2 million is very low then. The show has often been criticized for mixing rigorous and dubious science. Dr. Oz said in his Time essay that although he advocates alternative measures, he believes they should complement conventional treatment.
Why?
Not replace them. He said his opposition to legislation that would strip government agencies of their ability to label genetically modified foods is the primary reason he has been criticized. Oz tried to link some of the doctors with groups and companies that are against labeling genetically modified food, a practice that makes fruits and vegetables impervious to higher doses of herbicides when growing. Michael Cherenson, executive vice president of Parsippany-based Success Communications, said Oz is fighting so vigorously because his livelihood may be in jeopardy. But he said it should have never gotten to this point. Anytime you speak in exclamation points, you open yourself up for attack.
Boy, I would be target practice then. I'm loaded with exclamation points.
If Oz had the consumer's interests at heart, he should be willing to give a full, open, honest debate about this. So should his accusers, which will never happen. If neither party is willing to do that, I think it speaks volumes to their true motives.
Ain't gonna happen.
No, they do not debate. Unless they can control the forum and control the debate. Then they will debate.
Yeah. Well, I meant the cat trying to stare me down over here.
Oh. Yeah. Governor Christie's wife, Mary Pat, resigned as a top finance executive on Wall Street.
Oh, really? That's where she worked?
And this is the latest sign that the Christies are preparing to run for president. Mary Pat Christie was a managing director at Angelo Gordon & Company, an alternative investment firm with $27 billion in assets under management. Before joining the firm in 2012 is a significant date, she worked as a bond trader and vice president at the investment bank Cantor Fitzgerald. She's also known as a crucial political advisor and fundraiser, helping to guide her husband's career. Mrs. Christie has decided to take a hiatus from her work in the finance world to spend more time with her family and young children. The resignation came in the same week that Governor Christie extended his timeline for announcing whether he will seek the presidency. Appearing on The Tonight Show on Wednesday, Christie told host Jimmy Fallon, that the big reveal would come this month or next.
Boy, people like him sure get FaceTime, The Tonight Show.
He had said before that the decision would come early this year. In the meantime, political operatives close to Christie are fanning out to key presidential primary states, and a group of influential donors aligned with the New Jersey governor has formed a political action committee. Leadership matters for America.
Leadership matters for rich America. That's the only segment that will be helped by Chris Christie.
Your family is unbelievably affected by this, Governor Christie said last year. Their lives will never be the same. And so, we're thinking about it. I think it's good for me, good for my family, good for our state and country.
Nothing good about it, having him in office.
As recently as last week, the governor's wife said she was unsure what to do about her job if the governor jumped into the 2016 race. She told NBC it would be difficult to leave Wall Street. At Angelo Gordon, her work focused on strategic planning and marketing for distressed assets and bank debt. I do have a great job, she said. I'm not sure what I'm going to do with regards to that. But I know I want to spend a lot of time with my family. Of the four Christie children, the two eldest are college students. Andrew attends Princeton University and Sarah goes to the University of Notre Dame.
Is Andrew obese? I wonder.
I don't know. The new arrangement also frees up Mary Pat Christie's time to travel with the governor as he hits presidential primary states. She was with him at the rope lines in New Hampshire last week. But it will likely come at a cost. According to the Christies, 2013, a tax return, she earned $510,552. With Governor Christie's $475,850. Oh, wait, excuse me. That's what came from Angelo Gordon for her. And $34,698 coming from Cantor Fitzgerald. The governor's salary is $175,000. The Christies have requested an extension to file their 2014 tax returns as they do every year. Christie raised eyebrows when he told a New Hampshire crowd that Andrew's and Sarah's college tuition bills add up to $120,000. No college education is worth that.
Especially with this economy. No, it's not. It's not. I'm sorry.
A year.
They use a lot of schools have like outdated textbooks.
Which you have to pay for,
yeah. Right.
Mm-hmm. I don't consider myself a wealthy man, Mr. Christie said.
Well, it's relative. If you're a spoiled, pretentious bigwig, yeah, I guess you're not wealthy.
Chris and Mary Pat have been a team since they served in student government together at the University of Delaware in the 1980s.
Oh, boy.
while he pursued a career in public office. First as Morris County freeholder, then as a U.S. attorney, and now as governor. She became the family's main breadwinner, a prolific fundraiser for her husband, and one of his closest political confidants, along with his brother, excuse me, Todd Christie.
Oh, there's more?
We don't hear much about him. She is a co-equal branch of the enterprise, said State Senator Joe Krillos, a close friend of the Christies. She has an incredible career and has had it for 30 years now. Today, last week. So yeah, resigning would be a big sacrifice to ask from her, and it wouldn't be a requirement from my perspective. It's got to be about our lives.
Poor thing. Oh, the Christies.
Aside from her day job, she also has kept busy as First Lady over the years. After Superstorm Sandy battered New Jersey, she started the Hurricane Sandy New Jersey Relief Fund.
Yeah, what happened to the money?
Which had awarded $37.2 million in grants to housing assistance groups as of October.
Oh, really?
Well, why are all these people complaining? They have no money.
They didn't get the money?
Yeah.
Gee, I wonder where the money went.
Ah.
Subsidies for his rich buddies?
Well, look who's running the program.
Her.
Her.
Oh, gosh. It's not complicated to see the pattern with Republicans.
Just follow the money.
Follow the money trail.
Oh, you got it, buddy boy. I read that while human life expectancy has increased, human lifespan remains the same. If so, how can scientists account for the rising age of the oldest living humans since 1800, from about 100 years old to over 120 most recently?
And look at the quality of life, too. That's more important. Are you suffering? Are you decrepit? You know, are you, you know, incapacitated for those last years?
The outer limits of the human lifespan are genetic. But increased life expectancy, the oldest age in that lifespan that we're likely to reach, is due to better nutrition, modern medicine, and other environmental non-inborn factors. If the age of the oldest living humans has risen, it's because some genetic groups may have slightly longer lifespans than others, and they are benefiting from those same factors.
Yeah, nutrition plays a huge role.
Huge!
In the lifespan elongating nowadays. Yeah.
Telomeres.
Telomeres, the length of your telomeres. You know, there are supplements for that. We got one last one, right?
You want it to be last?
Well,
maybe I better pick a smaller, a shorter one, because this is...
What's that one?
This is about the pesticides harming our wild bees.
You know what? Let's do that. Let's, this is important. And then that will call it a week.
That's right, wait. A common type of pesticide is dramatically harming wild bees, according to a new study that outside experts say may help shift the way the U.S. government looks at controversial class of chemicals. But in the study published Wednesday in the journal Nature,
honeybees, which get trucked from place to place to pollinate major crops like almonds, did not show the significant ill effects that more efficient wild pollinators like bumblebees did. A finding some experts found surprising. This reminds me of a video I saw yesterday on Facebook where these buffalo or bison had gotten out of a pen or something of that nature and they were blocking the road. And you know how they were going to handle the problem?
They were going to kill them?
Kill them! That's right. Instead of herding them back to where the frick they belong, they're going to kill them.
Oh, these right-wing gun nuts, they're trigger-happy.
I guess they love to shoot at anything. And that's the solution to all problems. Kill them. Anyway, a second study published in the same journal showed that in lab tests, bees don't avoid these harmful pesticides. They may actually seek them out and get addicted to them, making the problem worse.
Yeah, I wonder why.
Bees of all kinds, crucial to pollinating plants, including major agriculture crops, have been in decline for several reasons. Pesticides are just one of many problems. This is separate from the colony collapse disorder, which devastated honeybee populations in recent years, but is now abating. The study found that exposure to neonicotinoid insecticides reduced the density of wild bees and resulted in less reproduction. And colonies did not grow when compared to bees not exposed to the pesticide. When the first results came in, I was quite, oh my God! Said the study leader, Arthur Major Runloff of Lund University in Sweden. She said the reduction in bee health was much more dramatic than I ever expected. University of Illinois entomologist May Berenbaum, who wasn't part of either study and last year was awarded the National Medal of Science, said that the studies indicate that at least with current technology, systemic use of pesticides is fraught with environmental problems. No kidding. The European Union has a moratorium on the use of neonicotinoids. Some environmentalists are pushing for the same in the United States. Runloff conducted her study just before the European ban went into effect in 2013. This paper has the potential of really shifting the conversation, said University of Maryland entomologist Dennis Van Engelsdorp, who was not part of the study. Neonics may have a very dramatic effect on these non-managed pollinators in the environment. This is the most definitive work I have seen in the area. Bee scientist Jeff Pettis of the U.S. Department of Agriculture said the Runloff study finds the pesticide is a real problem for wild bees, and it does it under real-world well-replicated conditions while using realistic doses. Environmental activist groups are using the study to step up pressure on the U.S. government to ban the pesticide. Lori Ann Bird, environmental health director at the Center for Biological Diversity, said federal agencies must step up and take action to ban these dangerous chemicals before it is too late to save our wild bees.
Hey, without our pollinators, the world will only have enough food for a short amount of time.
We will start.
Very short amount of time.
Yes, yes, yes.
I'm not positive as to the exact time, because I've heard different bits of information, but it won't be a long time. We will quickly run out of food.
Like maybe a year. Because, you know, whatever's in the ground will probably last a year, you know.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, pollination is predominantly done by bees. But, you know, pollen does get around in other ways.
Blows, insects on their feet, their body,
could be
whatever.
Butterflies, could be birds, it could be the wind.
Yeah.
You know.
Many things.
Anyway, thank you for joining us for Uncensored Hard-Hitting Truth. We'll see you next time. And next time might be... Would it be May? Next Saturday? Would it be May?
Yes, it would.
So what you're saying is this is the last show of April 2015.
I think Thursday is the last day of April.
This Thursday will be the last day. All right, so we'll see you in the merry month of May.
Yeah.
Mayflowers, man, Mayflowers. Cinco de Mayo. Cinco de Mayo, all you can eat, enchiladas, quesadillas, and such, tamales. Sounds good to me. Frozen margaritas, too. All right.
Hey, boy.
Yeah. We'll see you. Have a good week, people. Bye-bye.
This has been a Megalife 21 production.